Now, in this video, we're going to be looking at the rational zeros theorem. And basically, this is a way of helping us guess at what the likely rational zeros are for a polynomial. So, for a polynomial of a large degree, we could have zeros that are not rational. They could be real numbers that we get maybe out of some kind of quadratic formula if we can factor them to that extent. But they could be nasty, ugly things, or they could be rational. But if we want to reduce the polynomial, we need to find factors that we can factor out. So we need to find those. Again, if we're going to do long division, we don't want the square roots. We want the nice ones. So what we want to do, again, back in the day before there were computers, people would have to do this by hand. And so they wanted to make sure that they weren't checking a bunch of values that were impossible. And the main idea that we have here are that suppose we have a polynomial where the leading coefficient, we'll call it A sub one. Well, no, we'll call it A sub n just to be consistent. A sub n, x to the n. So that's our polynomial term of highest degree. And then we've got a bunch of other terms in the middle. And then our last constant in the equation is A sub zero. And what we want to be able to do is we're going to look at factors of the leading coefficient and factors of the final coefficient in order to figure out what the possible rational zeros could be. Again, they may or may not exist, but if they exist, there's only a certain number of things that they can become. So again, imagine that you're foiling out this equation. You have a bunch of linear, let's again, in the perfect scenario, you might have a bunch of linear factors, and the factors of your, the coefficients of your factors in your factored form. So AX plus B, CX plus D, EX plus F, etc., all the way down to yx plus z. If you had a factored form like this, then the leading term would be the product of all of the coefficients of the x's. So a times c times e times blah, 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 all the way down to y. And then the constant at the end would just be the product of all of the constants in your factors. So b and d and f and all the way down to z. So the idea here is to identify what are the possible factors that this constant could produce to give you these terms, and what are all the possible combinations of things that this can do. And then the solution, the zeros for the polynomial, would just be setting each of these factors equal to zero. So it would be the ratio of the factors of the constants divided by the factors, the possible factors of the leading term. So again, imagine we take one of our random factors. We set it equal to zero. What do we get? We get minus b over a as a possible solution for x. So again, this term was from the constant. This term is from the coefficient of x. So that's what we're looking for. We're looking for factors of this leading term and factors of this final constant term. And then we're going to find the ratio of all the possible combinations that we can get in order to get these possible factors. So we're going to say the factors of our leading term, a sub n, We'll call P, and the factors of A sub zero we'll call Q. And again, the factors of A sub zero will give us these constants. The factors of A sub n will give us these coefficients. And so the possible rational zeros will be plus and minus Q over P. Okay, so that's very important to kind of keep in mind. It's the factors of the constant divided by factors of the leading coefficient, because that's what would happen if we had linear factors that we could solve for each of these with. So now let's look at a specific example and then figure out what the possible rational zeros are. Now, so here's an example. This is a fourth degree polynomial. They're tricky to factor. But we have a leading coefficient of just one here, and we have a final coefficient of 12. And so our factors of a sub n, p, are just going to be equal to plus and minus one. And then q is going to be equal to, well, what are the factors of q? Well, plus and minus one, plus and minus 2, plus and minus 3, plus and minus 4, plus and minus 6, and plus and minus 12. And so then P over Q would then be, or sorry, Q over P. I always want to do it alphabetically, and it's not alphabetically. Q over P, again, is just going to be all of these divided by one. And again, the reason that we have both plus and minus versions is because we have multiple factors. And so we could have, so let's say, a complex one that produces a minus sign and for the final constant, and a non-complex one that produces another minus sign that gives us a positive 12. Or we could have two negative real ones that give us our rational ones that give us the 12. So we don't really know what the combination of signs is going to be because we don't know how the rest of the thing factors. These are just our best guesses. Now, one thing that this can do for us is they can give us a range of possible values we can check. If we had to, because we don't have technology, we could do long division. This would only be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, or synthetic division, 12 possible outcomes. 12 has a lot of factors, so that's a lot of checking. But again, it's a finite number. We know that we wouldn't have to check 8, for instance. And for this particular polynomial, we can actually check the graph, and we can see that we do, in fact, get zeros that are on this list. For this particular example, we have factors of negative 2 and negative 3 as possible actual rational zeros, which is great. And again, they're on the list of things that we can check. So since we do have technology, we can look at the graph and we can actually kind of confirm for ourselves, yes, in fact, these are possible rational zeros. Now, if we were to change the coefficients of our polynomial, then we wouldn't necessarily get these as the rational zeros. We might get no rational zeros at all, depending on exactly what these coefficients in the middle were changed to. They may or may not be factorable. If you take out one of these, or you change one of the coefficients, you change the way that the polynomial can or cannot be split apart. But you would still have only these options as possible rational zeros if, in fact, you got to a point where you found that you had checked all of these and they were all eliminated. None of them were rational zeros. You would have to conclude that there are no rational zeros for this equation. So this can be really super handy, both in terms of just like if I'm trying to graph this, what is a window that I can use in order to make to produce this graph to guarantee that I can see all the zeros? This is a way of doing that. It's usually a little too wide, but at least it gives you a place to start, and then you can zoom in from there. And if you see any rational zeros, then you can go ahead and you can identify them as being possible ones from your list. Now let's try one more that has a leading coefficient, just so we can see how that works. So let's try y equals 5x to the fourth. And again, the degree of the polynomial doesn't really matter. 3x cubed minus 10x squared plus 14x plus 12. And again, we have the same 12 on the end, but I've changed the leading coefficient here and some of the other coefficients. So again, what are our rational zeros? So the factors of 5 are plus and minus 1 and plus and minus 5. And the factors of 12 are plus and minus 1, plus and minus 2, plus and minus 3, plus and minus 4, plus and minus 6, and plus and minus 12. So the possible rational zeros are, well, we have this complete set from before. All of these guys divided by one are also possible. But now also all of the ones divided by five. So we could have plus and minus 1/5. We could have plus and minus 2/5, plus and minus 3/5. Plus and minus 4/5, and plus and minus 6/5, and plus and minus 12/5. And we need some commas. So these are now all the possible rational zeros. So now we can graph this and we can look at what the actual zeros are. And it turns out that the rational zeros for this expression are negative 2 and negative 0.6. Well, negative 0.6 as a fraction, that's negative 3/5. That was also in our list right here. So again, we don't have to have completely whole numbers. We can have ones that are not whole numbers. And so, yeah, we can figure out what the possibilities are. Again, this gives us a range of values. If we happen to see a zero, then we can identify it on the graph. And if it's in our list, like we know that this is a zero, we can construct the factor for it and then we can divide it out because yeah, we can take advantage of technology so that we don't have to literally do all of these divisions by hand. Whereas if we see one that kind of looks like it's a like we think maybe there's a five as a factor, but five is not in our list. that it's not actually five, it's some kind of non-rational real thing that we're getting from our quadratic formula or some other kind of formula, and therefore it's not one of our rational zeros, and therefore won't really help us factor the equation per se. So that's the sort of the point of our rational zeros theorem. We can use it for a couple of different things. We can give us a range of values if we're trying to figure out what do I have to graph to make sure that I get all the zeros on the graph. That's possibility one. And then I can use it to verify if I find a zero that that is one of the things that I'm allowed, that it's not irrational, that it is in fact rational. And then once I find those, then I can use that to factor out my problem. Remember that if I get 3/5 as the solution, I can divide, multiply through by the five, and my factor would be 3x minus 5x minus 3 would be a factor. And then, of course, x minus 2, x plus 2 would be my factor. I could divide those out, and that would leave me with a polynomial, quadratic in this case, since I started with an x to the fourth. And then that would give me, I could look for other zeros, maybe that are off the screen, or I could confirm that they are, in fact, complex by using my quadratic formula.